Good morning, fellow Toastmasters.
Good morning.
Well done. I hereby call to order this meeting of Lake Mary Toastmasters Club 6440, the very best Toastmasters Club that you will attend today. Before we begin, please silence your cell phones. You know how to do that. If your phone rings during a speech, you are earned $1.
Right.
Stand now for the pledge of allegiance, followed by a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please be seated. Our club has a mission. It's nice to have a mission. Focus is the mind. We provide a supportive and positive learning environment in which members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in greater self-confidence and personal growth. When you leave here this morning, you will have experienced personal growth and you will feel more self-confident. If you don't, return to us for rehabilitation.
Thanks.
And now I'd like to introduce our Toastmaster, Mr. Gus Davis.
Good morning, fellow Toastmasters and guests. We're welcome to our Toastmaster Club meeting for April the 18th, 2017. For those of you who are visiting as guests, a Toastmaster is the one who is in charge of the meeting. We run the agenda that we are giving in front of you. We'll try to follow this. But also the Toastmaster is assisted by other people in the room here. You will see how that will unfold. And one of the things I would like to take care of first is the agenda. There needs to be some adjustments and corrections. Our counter for this morning is going to be Shane Jasper. Our counter. And the evaluator number three. Oh, she already gave her book and cue to Phyllis. Sam, you will have to skip this down.
All right, you're good.
So we have those two adjustments that are already made.
What?
I chose a thing that is very...
Grammarian.
Oh, grammarian. My apologies. Grammarian is Stephanie. Stephanie is the grammarian. And in a few minutes, the hour counter, the grammarian, and the timer will tell us what they will be doing. And we'll see how that will go for the rest of the meeting. We just celebrated a holiday that was very commercial, religious, social, you name it, whatever it was. Friday, Saturday carried all of those. That's what we call Easter. And I've chosen that as the traditions we celebrate during Easter. I hope later in the morning I'll be able to tell you some of those traditions that we just celebrated. I think everybody think, well, Gus is leading it, pastor, we just talk about church. Of course I will. But there are other traditions that are celebrated at Easter. Can anyone think about just one?
Easter baskets.
Easter baskets. Another one. I'm going to get three.
Sunrise service.
Sunrise service, yeah.
Pelilis, I see them.
Pelilis? Okay, good.
Easter egg hunters.
Hunting ham.
There you are. So we know that food, fashion, and cultural expressions are all done during the season of Easter. So keep that in mind. I will tell you about some later on. Now I want to turn to our technical table who are going to tell us what they will be doing and how that affects everyone in the room, including guests. I will start with our grammarian, Stephanie. Stephanie?
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The grammarian's function, and it would have been mine normally, is to select a word of the day, a word that would be maybe not so commonly used anymore, a word you might want to resurrect, or a word that would relate to the theme. This word that was chosen for me is prodigious. It's an adjective, meaning extraordinary in size, or amount, or extent, or degree, or force. Prodigious. Like the National Debt. Way prodigious. Now, also, my role is to listen to grammar for exceptional or incorrect usage of grammar to help us in our speaking. I'll give a report at the end. Everyone speaking must use a word in the daily. They do not, they're going to pay 25 cents.
Thank you.
Thank you. And moving along, our art counter for this morning is Shane Jasper. Tell us what you
saw.
It's my function to raise as much money for the club as possible. A prodigious amount of money.
Prodigious amount.
There it is. I actually, as odd counter and being given some control, have decided to raise the price for the odds, welds, sews, butt lights, you know, double clutches, and other filler words. To 50 cents per word today. So 50 cents per word, be careful. We have someone giving their icebreaker, you are excluded from that today.
Lucky.
So that's what I'll be doing today.
Thank you. Even just going on
to I'm paying 50 cents for myself.
So that's right. Everyone who speaks, except for the Toastmaster, is time. Len is going to tell us what her function is as timer. Yeah.
Toastmaster, I'm losing my voice, so excuse me. I have a prodigious role as the timer this morning. My function is to time the speakers, evaluators, and table topic participants. To ensure they meet the timing requirements, I will demonstrate the timing lights, which will be displayed as follows. Green is for 5 minutes, yellow is for 6 minutes, and red is for 7 minutes for speakers, except for the icebreaker speaker, which will be, green will be 3 minutes, he asked for three, yellow will be 5 minutes, okay. And red will be 6 minutes. When we do table topics, green will be 30 seconds, yellow will be 45 seconds, and red will be 1 minute. And evaluators, green is 2 minutes, yellow is 2.5, and red will be 3. And I will report my results at the end. Thank you.
We move on to our three prepared speeches. Our first speaker, it's going to be given an icebreaker for those who are guests. That's the first speech you give to the club, to introduce yourself. Our first speaker wanted me to open up with the following quote. Argue for your limitations, and surely they are yours. Please help me to welcome Alejandra Saniz.
Saniz. I have to make it work. That's the title of my speech this morning. That's exactly what I'm thinking right now. I brought with me my pink screwdriver. Now that I think about it, it's probably not the best prop anyone has brought to a speech. But we'll get to the pink screwdriver in a little bit. Before that, I wanted to give you a little bit of a history, a background about myself. I wasn't raised in the United States. I didn't grow up speaking English, and as I'm sure you can tell by my very dark skin and very thick Latino accent, I was born and raised in Mexico. That's where I'm from. When I turned 16 years old, I wanted to come to the United States. I wanted to come to the land where milk and honey flows. And I told my parents I wanted to come to the United States, and after several talks over several months, they finally decided to agree to let me come to the United States. Part of the reason why they let me leave home at such a young age is that my sister already lived in El Paso, Texas, which is where I wanted to come. She lived with a few college friends first, and as much as any 16-year-old would love to live with a bunch of college girls, that wasn't really an option for me. So I lived with some of her guy friends from college. So I still had college roommates during high school, so I guess that's still pretty cool. And the high school that I wanted to join, they had an English test that you have to pass. And I sat through a test, and I felt really good about it, and I was very excited to hear the results. So the time came when the vice principal called me in to talk about my results, and I was just very excited to hear that I did very well and that I was going to join the high school. I should have known better that the vice principal doesn't give you the results unless there's some bad news, and surely enough, she told me that I failed the test and I didn't join the high school. She said,
you have an option. You can join the ESL classes, Remediation English, and in 1 year you can join the high school. The only problem with that is that part of the deal that I had made with my parents, especially my dad, he said you can't lose a high school year because of your English. You have to go into high school. And I didn't have that option of staying for 1 year, so I did the only thing I could do at the time, and I begged the vice principal, and I begged her for about 30 minutes. I can't wear it down. And eventually, she agreed to let me in with the most inspirational words that anyone has ever given me. She said, "Mr. Science, if you join the high school and you start failing your classes, I don't want any of that responsibility on me, and then you will be out of this high school for good." And I thought to myself, well, I have to make it work, right? And I did. It was a very long first year, lots of second-guessing myself and wondering why I was there. Lots of long nights and weekends studying English and trying to do my homework. I was able to graduate without failing any of my classes. And I went on to college in Iowa, out of all places. And that was another conversation I had with my family about moving even further when I was 18 years old. And I remember after 4 years, I graduated from college with my computer science degree. And that same year, I got married. My wife is from Florida. It's a long story about how we met. I'll spare you the details. Yes. And that same year, I was very obsessed with the idea of real estate, investing in real estate, and just flipping a house and becoming rich. And that's what I wanted to do, right? And I thought, you know, it's on the shelves, everyone is doing it. It sounds very easy. Mm-hmm. And I did what any loving husband would have done to his bride of 5 months. I convinced her to buy this house. And when I said convince her, there was more arm twisting than there was any talking. And we bought this house, $37,000. So you can imagine the kind of house that we purchased. And I told her, don't worry about it. It's going to take me 3 months to finish the whole thing. And at the time, what we had was this little pink toolbox that her parents had given her when she moved on to college, just to do things here and there. And I had no experience, and this screwdriver is the only thing that remains of that pink toolbox. All of the other tools didn't stand to the test of having a full house. And we purchased the house, and she was still very upset about it. She left Florida to come to Iowa. We were just married. And it really started the hardest year of our marriage up to this date. I wanted her to be in it, and I wanted her to be happy about it. So I thought, as much wisdom as a five-month married husband has, I figured I'll prepare this romantic dinner at the house the way it was. There was dust everywhere. He had that smell that no one's living in for 2 years. It was a worthless house. And I set up a blanket on the floor. I set up candles, I had some food, and as I'm finishing up, setting everything up, she's sitting there, and I looked at her, and she's crying. She has tears going down her eyes, and she looks at me and she says, "I can't believe you talked me into this." So she got up and she walked out of the house, and we didn't even start with dinner, so I got up, and I went over and I sat on the toilet. Now this toilet, we had this toilet sitting in the living room, so that probably didn't help with the whole romantic thing. I bought this toilet when we bought the house. I don't even remember why. Maybe I found it on sale. Maybe I thought a home starts with a working toilet. I don't know. But I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, you know what? This is my one shot. I have to make this work. And I was in that situation again. And I was in the same situation as I was in high school, where I just had to figure out how to do it. And 11 months later, not three, the house was moving really well, almost moving ready. There was still a lot of stuff to do. I had a lot more tools, a lot more knowledge at the time. And this screwdriver here became just a symbol of beginnings, and starting out a project with not the tools that you need, and starting out something you don't know what you need to do. And just knowing that you have the willingness to learn how to do it. And that's kind of why I'm here today, because I don't know how to do this, I don't have the tools, I just have a pink screwdriver, and I'm very excited to acquire the tools to do a lot more speaking.
1 minute on the clock, please, for the evaluation of your phone, that paperwork. Our next speaker, speaking from the entertaining speech project number 3, Make Them Laugh, a humorous speech from own experience, adapt and personalize humorous materials from outside source. Deliver speech, making the humor effective. Why I am crying. Please help me welcome competent communicator Jim Harris.
When I was a child, we had to have permission to laugh, especially around old people. So we learned to improvise at a very young age. And we discovered that there was something that was passed on from generation to generation, nonverbal. I remember one day, my mother was talking to my old Aunt Isabel. I was about 3 or 4 years old. And Aunt Isabel was married to my granddaddy's brother, Uncle Doc. And she was talking very, very fast. And all of a sudden, she reached in her mouth and pulled out her teeth so she could talk faster. And I fell down on the ground, laughing. And my mother told me, she said, listen, I promise you, don't laugh at old people. If you ever laugh at her again, I'm going to whip you. Okay, Mom. And she was good for her promises. So later on, this is in the country, this is in South Carolina. This is back in the 50s. We had outhouses and things that were common then are not common now. So later on, Isabel, they are talking. All of a sudden, this lady pulls up her dress, squats, and pees, and breaks wind like a horse. You know what I did? I cried. Nothing wrong with crying. She said, don't laugh. She said, don't cry. I cried so hard. I mean, I was shirking. My mother kept me, what's wrong with you, boy? What's wrong? And Mrs. Bell says, what's wrong with him? She says, he just doesn't feel well today. And I looked at her face, and my mother was like kind of biting her lip. There was a tear in her eye, and I could tell it. She wanted to just break loose too, but she couldn't. So she did. And then later on, as time went by, Uncle Doc came by the house one day. My mother would fry fish, and she would cook, and he'd come by, and he would always sneak something, you know. He'd turn her back, and he'd sneak something, he'd eat it. He drank something. So she had just finished frying this fish. She had taken this hot grease and poured it into like a coffee cup. She had strained it. It looked like coffee. And she turned her back, and he took a sip. And his mouth went, oh. And I cried. I just cried, you know. I don't know if you ever been to the Old Town revivals or not. Went to my first revival at about 3 years old. And in fact, back in those days, and probably some places now, the church and the cemetery are on the same piece of property. You know, you got the church, you have funerals, you have the service, you go outside, you have the bird right there on the ground. But anyhow, long story short, there was no burial, but they were having a revival. Man, and the people were running back and forth through the church. They were shouting, and they were jumping, and the building was shaking. This is my first time there. This is all new to me. I am on the floor under the pew, crying my eyes out. I don't know whether I was really crying. Oh, I was just laughing and having a great time. I said, Mama, they're going to tear the building down. It'll be all right. We went to this revival for a whole week. Then one night, you know, it's strange how some people who are not afraid are afraid of cemeteries and stuff. I'm not. And it seems to be that the drunks are not afraid of where they go. So one night, in right in the middle of all this activity, a drunk who had got entangled in his clothes wandered through the front door while this was going on. He looked like a walking dead body. Man, those people hit those windows. The whole building almost came down. And I just cried. My mama looked at me, and after a while, she just started to cry too. It wasn't because she wasn't used to this, because she was looking, you know, children are different than old people. Children have a sense of humor that we don't understand, we lose as we get older. Things that's normally funny to us, when we are young as a child, and you get old, you might completely lose that. I can remember when my daughter walked into the bathroom one day, and all of a sudden she just fell down on the floor and started just laughing. What was she laughing at? She saw a piece of rolled up toilet paper on the floor. I guess she had experienced that this is what happens to toilet paper when you use it and a piece fall on the floor and you don't pick it up. And to her, that was so funny. And because she laughed, I looked at her. And she, to this day, she still got that same sense of humor. Why am I crying? I am crying because I'm living with a bunch of old folks that do strange things. And you wonder, what will they do next? Well, my mama promised me. She said, if you laugh, the old people are going to whip you. So last time we were up there, we had a family reunion. And it was this young man who volunteered to sing a solo for the family. And he started to sing, and I'm grown now. All of our children just start rolling on the floor. The mothers were so embarrassed that they were pinching them and pulling them and squeezing them and telling them, shut up, be quiet. They couldn't hardly contain themselves. And then my old aunt, who then Aunt Barbara Lee was like 80 years old, she looked over. She bit her lip, and she gave him a squall, and the whole family just quieted down. After service was over, we all followed our bubbly out the front door, and she turned to the family and said, with her hands at her side,
She sounded like my grandmother. She's my father's twin sister. She said,
who in the hell told that Negro that he could sing?
No crying, 1 minute on the clock. Yeah. An important tool in training. More than 10,000 companies around the world use the web for training, and the number is growing. For this project, Alexander will be presenting a 5 to 7 minute training program, Communicating on Video, Project Number 5, Instructing on the Internet, How to Develop and Present an Effective Training Program on the Web. It's a video recording. So she will not be looking at the audience because she'll be in a studio and she'll be presenting and training this. She will be teaching the audience how to make 3 super easy flatbread recipes from fun family dinners at a TV program. Please help me welcome our advanced communicator, Silver, and leadership bronze, Alexander.
Thank you, good morning, and thank you again for joining my program this morning. And this morning, my objective is to teach you how to make 3 easy and prodigious easy flatbread recipes for fun family night. I don't know you, but me, I'm a busy mom. And taking care of 2 kids, at work, and a bunch of hobbies, I have no time to cook. But I found something that is really easy to make and make fun family dinners. This is the foundation of what I'm going to talk tonight, and this is a very versatile bread. It's called flat out, just like that, flat out, flat bread. And I really love this one because it has flaxseed and it's great for your fiber portion of the day. Now, what I love again about this bread is the versatility, like I said before, and you can make not only wraps, you can make tacos if you fold it on a different way. But today we are going to make simple, amazing and fun flatbreads that you can have your family included, they can help you, and you are going to have a bunch of fun. This morning, I'm going to introduce you to the first one, which is called the margarita flatbread. We are going to have the veggie version, and we are going to have the meat lovers version. The first thing that we are going to do for all of them is sauce. The one that I like to use is this one, is simple tomato sauce. And just grab a spoon, like I'm doing right now, and you are going to do spread that on the flatbread. Oh, this smells so good. Oh, I wish you all kind of smell this to the camera. This is amazing. Yummy, yummy. And this is the last one. bread is. Perfect. So far we have the flatbread as a foundation. We have our tomato sauce, and we are going now to do our third layer, which is as simple as mozzarella. So spread it, easy to do, grab it, and we are going to put that as our third layer on our flatbreads. So you can see how pretty this is looking. This is phenomenal. It's making me so hungry. As you can see, you may be thinking, well, these three flatbreads look the same, but you will see what we are going to do in a second. That's where you are going to start dressing your flatbread to give it personality, to give it a different flavor to each one. Ta-da! Now, we are going to do now our margarita flatbread. Margarita flatbread is really easy. It's as simple as your flatbread, your tomato sauce, your mozzarella cheese, and tomato. As simple as that, that's your margarita flatbread. And we are going to add to that one our, oh, I love this one, basil. Phenomenal. So just put some on top of your margarita flatbread. Oh, I love it. So you just do that. And this is my secret ingredient, sea salt. Love it. Just put it right there. And if you want, add oregano, up to you. These are optional ingredients. I really love oregano, and I'm going to add it to this one. Ta-da, let me introduce your margarita flatbread. This is our first version. Our second version is our veggie. As simple as you have your flatbread, tomato sauce, mozzarella cheese, now you add mushrooms.
Mushrooms.
Yes. Hongos en español. Now on this one I want to add, because it's the veggie version, I'm going to add arugula. I think I pronounced this correctly, but arugula. There we go.
Okay, the English can't pronounce
it. So this one, we just spread it out like that. And that's our veggie version. I love oregano on everything. And sea salt.
Love it.
Ta-da, let me introduce you our second version, our veggie flatbread. Again, flatbread, tomato sauce, mozzarella cheese, mushrooms, and arugula. Now, the last version is for the meat lovers. Meat lovers could be any meat, pork, meat, chicken, shrimp, you name it, anything that is meat. Right here, we are going to do this morning chicken, again, on our layers of flatbread, tomato sauce, mozzarella, we are going to add chicken.
Pollo.
Or bacon. Anything that is meat. Love my audience, you're so helpful. And on this one, I love rosemary. So let's add rosemary to my meat lover ones. Oh, no. Rosemary on that one. And guess what I'm going to add now?
Oregano.
Oh, yeah.
Sea salt.
Yes. Sea salt. And then oregano. Yes. Love it. Well, as you can see, it's not even probably 5 minutes now, 6 minutes, and we were able to accomplish, like I, at the beginning I said, my objective was to teach you three amazing and fun and prodigious recipes. And this morning we just finished in 5 minutes our margarita flatbread pizza, and we just finished as well our veggie version and our meat lovers. You can do this with your kids, you can do this with your significant other. This is perfect if you drink it with a glass of white wine, and you are going to have so much fun. Let your kid be creative. Add pineapples. I know some people don't like pineapples, but you can add those, and you are going to have the best dinner ever. Hopefully this was helpful this morning, and let me get you back to our Toastmaster, those days.
Yes. Oh,
thank you.
But you didn't know.
Can we throw those in the oven here?
Yes, yeah. I know.
Where's the oven?
Thank you, timer. Part of the exercise as Toastmasters for our guests is the section where we call it table topics. And in table topics, it's the time that we're going to have a member come up and we choose based on the theme or the speech, whatever, so that everyone who does not have a function for today, we have the opportunity to speak. So please help me welcome Table Topic Master, Mike Hughes.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Table Topics, where I get to ask you questions and you have to answer for 30 seconds, otherwise you fail. So I came up with a couple of good questions based off the speeches we heard today. So let's get this kicked off with a crazy question. Have you ever had to move away from home and start a new adventure, but you were very afraid to do it? Katie.
I have actually. I went, I'm from Texas and we moved to Florida when I was 14 years old. And it was in a small town in Florida. And when the time came for college, I was the first person in my family to have gone to college. And I moved to Orlando on my own with a couple of friends. And I went to Valencia for a little while and ultimately finished at UCF. It took me a lot longer to finish college, I think, than some other people because I was working my way through. I didn't really have a lot of money to begin with, and my parents were able to really fund that. So I was very proud of myself by the end of it because I really was able to work my way through. So I think it was a good experience.
Have something from your past that is a reminder and a symbol that keeps you going strong, Dr. Bucky.
Mr. Table Topics Master, fellow Toastmasters, and guests, has anyone but me ever noticed how prodigious Mike is with his opportunity to give me a reason to speak when I have no role? Thank you, Mike. Now, what was the question again?
Do you have a symbol that keeps you going strong, much like a screwdriver?
I do. And actually, I just found it not long ago. Most of you know I had this major household move over the past few months. Can't find anything still. Jean, thank you for the communicator book. I found my father's watch that I had packed away in storage. And I took it out, and I remember so much about my father because he was very tan, more so than me. And he wore his watch on his left wrist, and that was the days when we didn't have faces that looked like this, except in print. We had no electronic watches. My father wore this watch every day of his life, as far as I can remember. It still worked. The date and the time don't turn yet, and it rattles funny, but it keeps time when I wind it, and I wear it. So I've been wearing it to remind me of his resilience, his honoring of education and learning, and always stepping forward in his faith, both at the beginning and at the end of his life. he was a magnificent role model, and that watch reminds me that he is still with me today.
Excellent. Changing topics just a little bit. What is something funny that you got whipped for as a kid or as a child? Bob.
Honored guest, Brother North, from the National Speakers Association.
NSA.
My mother warned me that if I didn't behave, she was going to give me a whipping. And I didn't behave. So she said she was coming in to whip me, and I took pillows and put them under the bed. And I took a little face mask and put it by the pillow, and I covered it over, and I went in the closet and hid. And she came in with a belt, and she was smacking the. And I thought that was just the funniest thing that I even cried. It was the funniest experience.
Excellent. Well, thank you.
You helped me with Easter traditions, you named a couple of those. The one I really remember, I've had from the sunrise service, Easter service, the whole gamut in my faith tradition, and having the food and the passion. But when I live back in Sierra Leone, it's the Easter Monday is the biggest holiday we celebrate. You know what I like best about that was always we have to do our kites. You know, we spend days building our kites, and then we have to go down by the beach and to just, you know, see our kites going up and waving in the air. I will never forget that. It's hard for me to tell my daughters that was one of the Easter traditions that my mom and dad passed on to me. And they always told us the reason why we did the kites, so that you can imagine how Jesus went into heaven. Thank you. I will now turn the portion of this meeting over to our general evaluator, who will tell us what that is about, and then she will invite the others to participate. Welcome, Julia Coffin.
Thank you, guys. Good morning. This is our educational portion of our meeting, where we get to hear some prodigious evaluations by our wonderful speakers that we had today. We're going to get right to it with our first evaluation of our icebreaker. Please welcome Stephen Morgan to the lecture.
The most important speech you give in Toastmasters, the first one, the icebreaker. Now, Alejandro, you did the most important thing you need to do for the icebreaker. You survived. The key is to get up here and do it for the first time, to be able to see that it's not nearly so scary as it may seem. If not for you, then at least for everyone else who has to watch and think, I have to do that. You did a great job with this. Yes. And the most amusing and amazing thing in all this was the prodigious humor you threw right into it from the very beginning. In fact, showing you even had a grasp of the English idioms with the land of milk and honey.
Yes.
But also your desire to become rich, you've definitely fit into the American mold real quick. And you had to throw in toilet humor. I just see had to come in there. Even James was dragging it in. It just seems to always find its way into all of this. The next speech you're going to be giving is going to get into the structure of a speech. And a couple of things I'll point out since that'll be the next thing to go into. You had the introduction quote in there. I wasn't sure where it tied in, or if it was supposed to, or if you intended to, or if it was just supposed to set the mood. The opening was very unclear as to where you started, because it was kind of, I'm easing into it, and everyone does this. It's more interesting if you can make a very clear opening and say, this is where I'm starting, looking at the audience that way, and know exactly what you're going to start with as to, I don't know why I'm carrying this. Something to think about next. But your closing, when you turn it around and suddenly got philosophical and turn it around from my story into how it applies to all of you. Excellent. A wonderful style. That is how an inspirational speech is supposed to end. And very well done with that. In fact, what you showed was something you won't find in the manuals. It takes a lot of work for people to actually learn it, but for those people who have it naturally, when you can know how to build up tension and then release it for the audience. Because you did that in a way that was far beyond even many advanced speakers, and how you were building up your high school story and all the work you had to go into just to survive to get to where you're going, and suddenly you went to Iowa. Everyone started laughing. All of this suddenly built up, and suddenly that was not what I expected. And then all of the work you put into for your wife, she gets up and walk out. So you go sit on the toilet. Which was in the middle of the living room, is that what I understood? Yet, out of place, unexpected, that is the brilliant way to get people involved, pulled in, and then let go of that tension, and then everyone gets to enjoy it at the same time. That was brilliantly done. You may not even know you were doing it. If you planned that, very good. If you didn't know you were doing that, you need to actually sit down and figure out how you did that, those steps, because if you can work that further to the point where it's not just that it's a natural thing, but it's also a deliberate thing, then you put it into other parts of the speech, it starts flowing in a way that's going to be you steering the audience where you want them to go. So I'll have to tell you this, where you ended up telling us, I don't know how to do this, oh no, I beg to differ. Yeah. You know exactly how to do this. Madam General Valle.
Evaluator, that'll be Ernst Urbanchuk, evaluating James' humor speech. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Welcome to our Toastmasters honored guests, and especially James. Actually, your speech inspired me to give a speech. Your speech, and actually also the word of the day, which means prodigious, extraordinary in size. And I signed up for a humor speech 4 weeks from now, ailments of men up to 70. And I think you guys really well into this. The overall question I have to answer is one. Number one, was it humorous or was it not? Or so-so? So the best way of doing this, I like to have audience participation. Number one being so-so, number 10 being, wow, so let's see what you think. First, number one, show of hands.
You might want a lower, smaller scale.
Or so-so.
So-so, and then let's go number 10. Yes, actually, I felt you did a superior job. What I would have done if I was you, especially as you give a funny talk, it was humorous, I would really remove this podium, or lectern rather, and go out in the audience and connect with them right away, rather than trying to do the opening here. Was your opening funny? As a child, we had to ask for permission to laugh, and did the aunt take her teeth out and squat it? Well, you know, we don't have to go back 50 years or whatever time that was, because 75% of the population right now do exactly the same thing all over the world. So it's funny, but it relates back to what is happening today. So you had a great opening, move this back. What should you have done different? Of course, I said move things back during, but also, don't laugh at your own jokes. If you think about Bill Crosby, Chris Rock, George Carlin, Richard Pryor, when they give a joke, you know, they look at someone and hopefully the audience gets it and go crazy about it. They never ha 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 laugh at their own joke. Which I know it's tough to do because I do the same thing, but really, and that's one of the things we have to overcome, but really, in order to resonate that particular sentence is to stop and look at somebody and see if they get it. So that was one thing I would suggest. What you did really well, you were very specific about your experiences. You actually lived it. It's not something you just grabbed out of the air, some off-the-wall joke, so you did this. It was very funny about the hot grease in coffee. I can just see that happening. In fact, my uncle, many, many years ago, used We used to have to spray your shoes with, sweat shoes, to make it clean. He sprayed his hair by mistake because I thought it was a hairspray. So it can happen. The story came from your heart and you really experienced it. Well, you did a great job. Thank you very much. And keep on with the funny jokes.
Later, but this was Alexandra's last speech in the surprise, surprise that Alexandra chose this one, communicating on video.
Yes.
From Alexandra's profession. The main purpose of this this speech was to make sure that the objectives of what she was trying to present on video were accomplished and that she was making the connection with the video on the recorded presentation. And overall, Alexandra, you did a great job. Could you not all see her as the next Martha Stewart or another one just going through and giving this demonstration? Because it was excellent. She started right out with, here's what I'm telling you. I'm going to tell you about these three projects. Here's why I'm going to give you these projects. And she went right into it, explained them all, took you through it step by step. It was great. The other thing she has, which I think makes that video connection for her, for you that you did so well, is you maintained that energy and enthusiasm throughout. I know what I would do because when I get into a project, I may be engaging here at the beginning, but once I'm working on the stuff, my mind starts focusing here, and so I'd probably be down here the whole time. So I was watching you specifically, and I noticed throughout the whole thing, you didn't look at the audience, which was also, I would have engaged, because I love looking at everybody in the audience and making eye connection, making sure you're seeing me and hearing me. But I saw you kept your eye, and it's probably from your professional training, you kept your eye right on that camera, and you were engaging. Even when we have our interactions, as we sometimes do, you still kept your connection right there with that video. You even talked about us, but you kept your connection right there on the video. It was great. My suggestions for altering this, and this has to do mostly with subject matter, is maybe having presented all of your ingredients ahead of time. Of course, if you had more time to work with, so that everybody kind of knew what materials you were working with to begin with. And then I think at the very end, you kind of wrapped it up, because that was, for this presentation, what you could have done. Of course, if you were in a kitchen, you would have given us the baking instructions and presented it on a plate. Those were the only material, like subject matter things, I thought that could be improved upon. Again, it cannot be reiterated enough, that connection that you made with the video. She was comfortable the whole time. She didn't, even though she was changing from what we normally do here in speeches, you were comfortable right there with the video the entire time. You were relaxed. It was great. I was very proud to be able to evaluate you on the speech. Thank you very much, Alexandra.
Performed in front of
all right,
let's
get to our technical table. We've got just a couple minutes to go through it. Let's start with our off counter. How'd we do, Shane?
Madam General Evaluator, we made some money. As a matter of fact, I even tallied up the totals because I'm such a nice guy.
He's good.
Gus, two Oz, and a for a total of $1.50. Shane, have so for a total of 50 cents.
So far.
Lynn, two Oz for a total of $1. James, one butt, two you knows, four double clutches for a total of $3.50. Alexandra, clean. So hungry, I didn't pay. Mike, two sows, $1. Katie, two Oz, one sow for $1.50. Julia Bucky, one sow for 50 cents.
I'm crying.
Bob, clean. No. Julia K, clean.
Up there.
Woohoo!
Stephen, clean. No one's surprised by that.
Yeah.
Ernst. Twice you said so-so.
Oh.
I charge you for it since you're the treasurer.
Two double clutches at the same time.
You have one butt and two double clutches. So a total of $3. You need money, buddy. Phyllis, one one you know. No, I'm sorry, it was a like, and three double clutches for $2.50. And that is my report.
Wow.
And I will charge our timer and our grammarian penalize.
Okay. All right. Quickly, we're running out of
quickly,
time.
Quickly, Alejandro, 6 minutes, 29 seconds. James, 8 minutes and 28 seconds. Alexandra, 7 minutes and 16 seconds. On the table topics, Katie was 42 seconds. Judy, 1 minute and 30 seconds. And Bob, 36 seconds. And valuation, Stephen was 3 minutes, 15 seconds. Ernst, 3 minutes, 25 seconds. And Phyllis, 2 minutes and 30 seconds. That's
fine. Thank you.
I'm
going
to have to make this as quick as I can.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Word of the day was used by Shane, Lynn, Alexandra twice, Mike, Julia, Stephen, Ernst. Anybody else? No. Everybody else who spoke? And you have your icebreaker. What is it? A quarter? A quarter. By the way, divide his fines by 10.
Yeah.
All right. James Harrison. Walking dead body, that was funny. Now, you said scrawl. I think that was a scowl or
scowl,
something, but he made up a new word, scrawl.
I like it.
Okay. Stephen, idioms and toilet humor. Only one break today. Resonate, Ernest, and something else you said. Phyllis, only four breaks today. there were a couple others of incorrect grammar. I'll let her know. She was frying grease, that's what. Julia, Bucky, anyone but me, should have been anyone besides me when you said that. Okay. That's it, that's my report.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, welcome back.
Good to see you.
So I'm doing club business, and we've got a lot, so I'm going to be as quick as possible. Hopefully I won't be able to, if I could, I would remove my teeth so I could talk fast. Looking forward to that one day. All right, so first up, 50-50 raffle. While we're going on, if anybody wants a 50-50 raffle, make sure you do that. Auction items. If you have auction items, that's coming up. My alarm just went off for 2 weeks from today. So let's get that. Make sure we're moving forward on that. I had something else there. I don't remember it. So let's get right into our great things that we're waiting for. First and foremost, we had a great Alpha and Omega. So we have Alejandro Sainz. Come on up.
Sainz.
Advanced Communicator Gold. Okay, sorry, I thought that was a step further, but Advanced Communicator Gold.
Wow.
All right.
We're going out for drinks tonight.
Here it is.
Oh, see there, we have
here
the pens.
Throw it out.
Oh.
I thought there was something.
Let's do your pens.
There
we go.
Is.
We found the pens.
Come on,
quick.
We're running late. We're running late.
Here it is.
It's 2:04.
All right.
It's 2:04.
So then we have scheduled in visitors. Schedule next week, we have Sergeant Orange Jean. We need a Toastmaster. Any volunteers real quick? We'll go up, we'll have email go out. Then we have speakers, Bob, Carrie, and Shane. Everybody's good?
Good.
Table topics, Mike again. Thank you, Mike.
Yes.
General Evaluator Ernst. We need two more evaluators. We got Julia for the first. We need two more evaluators. Any volunteers? All right, James, and...
I do one.
All right, an all-counter and grammarian.
81?
Yes, you just said you could vote evaluator, I'm sorry. Yes. Write it down. All-counter grammarian, or grammarian. Email will go out. Oh, James, we have used timer, too, so we'll need a timer. All-counter grammarian timer.
Grammarian,
grammarian, thank you, Lynn.
I'll do all-counter.
Katie, you go by Katie?
Yeah.
You do an all counter?
No, Katie.
All right, Katie. Timer? Anybody have a problem here?
I love Saturday.
All right, Alejandro. All right, so we just need a Toastmaster. We just need a Toastmaster. All right, and we have three guests today. So traditionally, what we do is we ask our guests if they would stand up and give us a brief 30 seconds to a minute, just what you thought of our meeting today. So, Desiree? Hi, Desiree. Would you mind standing up and giving us your impression?
Hi, I'm Desiree Bailey. I'm Julia's friend from North Carolina, Disney. So, the early hour, I commend y'all for getting up at that crazy time and coming here to meet. But I thought it was a lot of fun. I see a lot of diversity, which I think is great. You can learn a lot from that. So it was very enjoyable. Thank you for having me.
Welcome. And we have Lexis. Welcome.
You heard, my name's Lexis. I'm Sam's little sister. I had a lot of fun today. Like, you as well. It was kind of hard getting up early to come out here, but I think you guys really pinpointed the exact, what's the word I'm looking for, point of constructive criticism. So what you guys did, you're very encouraging, but also like told everybody what they could improve on, but then was also even more encouraging. And I really like that, so I know if I ever come to this, I will be encouraged.
And last but not least, Norm.
Hi, Norm.
The energy in this room is absolutely fantastic. This is my first Toastmasters meeting, although I've been involved with the National Speakers Association for more than 25 years. I heard about Toastmasters, but I had no idea it was such a fun group. You guys are awesome, and the guts it takes to get up in front of the group and do something that's very awkward, and it comes across great. I love the energy of every person that is speaking, not only the speakers, but also all the team that are doing all the things, like having all the ahs and the timers, and well-organized, fantastic group, enjoyable. I had more fun than I thought I was going to have.
All right.
Why didn't you do that so long?
We appreciate you guys being here. Hopefully you'll come back and visit us another day. With that, we are 5 minutes overdue. Yeah. Have a great day today, guys. Good job.